Well, today my conversation is with Anne Williams. She's the general editor of National Geographic's Lost Cities, Ancient Tombs, 100 Discoveries That Changed the World. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Thank you for having me. This is fun.
Oh, I love Egyptology. Ever since I was a little kid in history class, we were learning about Egypt. The teacher reminded me of Nefertiti. I got turned on to it ever since. So your book here, it's so comprehensive. It doesn't just cover Egyptology. It chronicles 100 astonishing discoveries, of course, including the Dead Sea Scrolls. I saw those when I was in Israel. When did your interest for history begin?
I went to college thinking that I was going to be an English major, and it turned out that I hated the English department. But I had taken an archaeology course to fulfill a history requirement when I was a freshman, and then I liked it, and I took some more, and I ended up majoring in it, and I got my master's, and I've been connected to the field ever since. Now, I've earned my living as a journalist.
Yes.
Because it's hard to make a living as an archaeologist, yeah. As many people will appreciate. Yeah. Not easy to make a living as a journalist either. But journalism has been my career for the last some decades. But I've been very lucky at National Geographic. I mostly focused on science and was able to cover a lot of archaeological discoveries. And, you know, that was always just very satisfying and exciting.
Yeah, I love your room. I love all the artifacts on the walls and the painting. What's the painting of?
Well, so the painting is of a village in Colombia. My husband and I were on a cruise going through the Panama Canal. I think it was the 50th birthday of one of us. And we went on one of these tours and went into a place that, you know, I just looked around and I thought, oh my goodness, full of, you know, tourist icky things, yeah, that I wouldn't want to buy. And right. Then I looked up, and up toward the ceiling, they were all of these gorgeous folk art paintings.
Wow.
And I said, are these for sale? Well, yes, they are. And I said, well, I'll have that one. And a man came along and took it down for me and took it off the frame and rolled it up. I felt like an art smuggler.
Right.
Put it in my suitcase, brought it home, took it to my favorite framer, who is an artist in his own right.
Yes.
And that's where, and I hung it in my office. I very often look at that because it is so rich. It is all about village life. You see the church, you see the market, you see the buses coming in,
Is that like what the city of gold was that was discovered? Was it all of those things wrapped up in one?
The city of gold. Oh, that new thing in Egypt.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, so that is a very interesting story from two perspectives. First of all, from the archaeological perspective, and second of all, from journalism. I think that the headlines were a little over the top. But the interesting thing about that town is that so much of the ground plan was preserved. I have friends who have walked through those streets who say really is just an extraordinary experience. And the very cool thing are those S-shaped walls. They are really very beautiful. But
they like curve.
Yes. Well,
and the brick is beautiful. It's like what happened to these people? Like they just disappeared one day.
Well, I will get to that in one moment. I'm glad you brought that up. The thing about those walls is that by making them sleek like that, you can use fewer bricks and your wall is skinnier. So it's not only a very beautiful wall, but it is a very strong wall, of course. It has lasted for, 3,000 years? So, I mean, that, you know, for an archaeologist, that was very cool. Now, you have just gotten to one of the big questions that sort of drives me. You know, why did these civilizations come to a screeching halt?
Yeah.
you know, what on earth happened to the ancient Egyptians or the Maya or right. the Inca or, you know, the Indus Valley civilization, yes. the sites of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa. I mean, what happened to these folks? Their civilizations were robust and sophisticated, and they invented a whole bunch of stuff like calendars and astronomical observations. You know, what happened to them? Yes. You know, I would like to know. I don't have any answers. But
it was eerie. It was, yeah. it was so like emotional for me to see that. I don't know what, even talking about it, I don't know what it is, but it just, cause it's around for so long and it looked like there's pottery that was found, jewelry that yeah. like where it's, it was breathtaking because to be able to walk that ground, it almost would feel like it would be sacred, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Now, are you learning how to read hieroglyphics? I read somewhere you were doing that.
I am. So there is a wonderful hieroglyphs expert, Melinda Nelson-Hurst, who teaches at Tulane in New Orleans. And she does a number of things. She has a whole bunch of things on YouTube where she will talk about a hieroglyph for 4 or 5 minutes. And tell you what it is, how it came to be, and how it's used. And those mm-hmm. snippets are wonderful. It's called Hieroglyph a Day. But she also, this summer, had a thing that she called Scribal School. And it was several weeks of online videos. And then we have our own private Facebook group where we share information about, yeah, what is this hieroglyph? I can't yes. find it anywhere. And so I'm a graduate of Scribal School. And it really, I am, you know, now as we speak, writing a book for National Geographic about ancient Egypt.
Oh, I can't wait to talk to you about that.
That study of hieroglyphs is really helping me. For instance, there was a photograph and it had a cartouche, in other words, a royal name on it. You know, I could see the oval, but I couldn't, you know, it looked weird.
Yeah.
And then I realized, well, of course it looked weird. The photograph was upside down and the hieroglyphs were upside down. and I knew that because I had just graduated from Scribal School. So yeah, I am also, you know, the way ancient Egyptian names are transcribed has a lot to do with how we think the hieroglyphs were actually pronounced. And so different names are spelled different ways in English, depending on how you think that hieroglyph was pronounced. And
yeah.
Because I have now been to Scribal School, I have formed opinions about how ancient royal names should be spelled. And I am spelling them that way in my new book.
Oh, I can't wait to talk to you about that. That sounds so exciting. You know, when I knew I was going to talk to you, like back in the 70s, I mean, like I said, I don't even know where the attraction came from. It had to be obviously from a history class, but you know, back in the 20s, Egyptian jewelry was like really, really popular, yeah. right?
Yes, yes, yes. And no. Oh, yeah. My goodness.
Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah, the elephant, the cool star one. And the moon, the scarab, the pharaoh. And then I have this that I also bought back in the 70s. It's scarabs, right? So what's the significance? Cool. Why so many scarabs?
Well, so here's the thing. Ancient Egyptians were very keen observers in the animal world. Of course, it was an agrarian society and they were surrounded by the natural world. And they saw dung beetles rolling balls of dung across the desert. And they made the connection between the dung balls rolling and the sun as an orb rolling across the sky.
Oh, wow.
And so the scarab rolled the sun across the sky as it rolled the balls of dung across the desert. that's one of the really cool things.
I love that. How do you think archaeology can help us now, like help us understand our history and kind of make sense of, I don't know, where we're the past and where we're going?
Well, so I've thought about that in connection with this book. I think that as we read through this book, we see how creative and smart and really resilient our ancestors were. And they got through some really tough times without the benefit of modern medicine or modern science. And yet they were able to leave us these extraordinary legacies. And I think we have to bear in mind what our ancestors did and take confidence, take inspiration by that fact, and realize that we will do the same. We will get through these tough times and we will leave very wonderful legacies for the people who come after us.
I love that. What span do you cover in the book? We're mostly talking about Egyptology, but you cover everything. There's things, there's Colorado here in the States, Virginia. What span?
We begin with the Laetoli footprints laid down in Tanzania 3.6 million years ago by some early humans, and we go right through to the sinking of the Titanic in April 1912 and Bob Ballard's discovery of the ship in the 1980s.
Wow.
And everything in between that was, you know, cool and interesting and exciting.
Yeah, I mean, just you look at this book, there's photographs, it's such a comprehensive book, and it must have been really difficult to edit, to pick out like your favorite 100, but you have a chapter in there. I was at Masada when I visited Israel. You've got a chapter called The Standoff at Masada. What happened there?
Well, that is open to interpretation, and I will leave that to the experts.
Okay.
But my question for you is, did you walk up or did you take the funicular?
We walked up.
I walked up too, yes.
It was wild.
That's the defining question about modern Masada. Did you walk or did you
drive? We walked up, and we went there also like in the middle of the night.
Oh my goodness.
And we're able to walk at midnight, walk the streets. There was some weird, remember that orange tree that was hanging upside down? Did you see that?
It was
in like a village, like a little area on the outskirts. And someone had like an orange, I don't know if it was a piece of art or what, but it was an orange tree. It wasn't hanging upside down. It was hanging up. And I said, I remembered, like, I wonder how they like get the oranges. Do they just wait for them to fall down? It was one of the most beautiful areas that I saw. And we went all over Israel. Did you feel that way as well?
I did. It was a really magical sight, among many of the magical sites in Israel.
For sure. You know, what the people did with building, like when you picture a lot of walls and cities, the engineering, using limestone, the great builders of the Tower of Babel. You have that in here in your book as well.
I don't know a whole lot about that. So again, I will leave that to the experts. I did not write that chapter. I wrote about a third of the chapters in the book.
Yes. And because you edited this, right?
I edited
all this information. Yeah. What is one of your favorite stories from the book? What is there something that, or a couple? I'll give you a couple of them.
A couple. Well, you know, my great amateur passion is ancient Egypt. And so one of my favorite sagas is the saga of King Tut and the discovery of his tomb. Now, you know, my mother tells me that when I was 2 years old, I stood in front of a mirror in a new coat and just preened and said, I like the pretty of it. And so I like the pretty of all of the things in King Tut's tomb. I mean, I'm that kind of a person.
Me too.
I think also, because that tomb was found almost intact, the tomb tells us so much about who King Tut was, how he lived, the times that he lived in, and also Howard Carter, the archaeologist who discovered the tomb, spent 10 years cataloging all of Tut's stuff. And there are modern archaeologists, Jaromir Malek in England, among other people, who have digitized all of Howard Carter's notes.
Oh, wow.
So we have sort of a wonderful trifecta of stuff. We have an almost intact burial. We have a diligent super note taker in Carter, and we have the folks in England at the Griffith Institute at Oxford who have digitized all of Carter's notes.
Amazing.
If you want want a deep dive into King Tut's stuff, that's the place to go. Google Griffith Institute.
Yeah.
And I think it's called Anatomy of an Excavation. And you could just dive in. You can look at all 5,000 plus artifacts. So that's one of my favorites on one end. The other end is a very much more subtle, smaller scale thing. It was a settlement in what is now England, about five buildings, you know, not big. Houses made of wattle and daub walls, thatched roofs, sort of an agricultural community living by the river. So they must have fished and did some farming and hunting and gathering. And 3,000 years ago, something bad happened. A spark flew from somewhere, maybe a fire, maybe who knows what. And maybe it caught one of those thatched roofs and the whole thing went up in flames, which means for the archaeologists that there's a lot preserved there just because, you know, it burnt. But the other thing, people left and they left things in place. So in one house, you have a bowl with porridge in it and the spoon still in the bowl. So you have to imagine this is one of those moments that connects us so intimately to people in the past. Somebody was eating her breakfast.
Right.
And the alarm went out, you better run now. Yeah, and she didn't even take her breakfast with you, her. She ran away. Well, you know, bad for her, she didn't get breakfast, but good for the archaeologists who came along. So this tells us what she ate and the implements she ate it with in this house that she lived in. And so it's moments like that also that I think are wonderful snapshots to the past. So you have King Tut on one hand and, you know, this thing, it's called the Must Farm on the other. And, you know, two extremes, but really informing us wonderfully about the past.
Yeah, and I remember Pompeii, right? Same thing, kind of preserved with the woman with putting bread or something in the oven. Like, I haven't even thought about that for, you know, many, many years. And here.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
well, that's a very exciting site. And the sister site, Herculaneum, is very exciting. And this brings us round to, well, two chapters in the book. There was a chapter about Pompeii and Herculaneum, who were sort of pleasure towns for wealthy Romans to come and, you know, have a nice holiday by the seaside.
Right.
But they also point to revolutions that are going on in archaeology because of new technology. So at the end of this book, Lost Tombs, Lost Cities, Ancient Tombs, there is a chapter on new technologies that are revolutionizing the field of archaeology. And one of them is the ability to peer through all of the charred scrolls from the library at Herculaneum. When the first discoverers found them at Herculaneum, they broke open the scrolls. They knew there were things written on them and they broke them and, you know, destroyed whatever was written. Now people are starting to be able to look into those scrolls without doing anything to them and starting to figure out what those scrolls said. Technology is really opening up whole new chapters of archaeology in really wonderful ways.
Yeah, I bet in your field, it must be so exciting. When you've gone on digs, right?
I have been on a few, yes.
What's that like? You're just kind of gently brushing sand away, right?
Yep. You have you have your trowel and you have a thing called a patiche, which is a triangular headed hand pick. And, you know, brushes. And I've seen archaeologists use a lot of different things. You want to use tools that don't damage the artifacts. So lots of archaeologists, for instance, use bamboo skewers that are used for shish kebabs because they won't harm the artifacts. Other people use dental picks, you know, for very delicate excavation. You have to dig as carefully as you can, as quickly as you can, because, you know, time is money. and you've usually got a grant of some sort, and you know, you're trying to get the artifacts out of the ground with as much information as you possibly can and be respectful of the evidence that is emerging from the past, but being mindful of the fact that, you know, time is limited. You may have a 2-week field season, and you know, you can't just sit there by the side of the dig and think great thoughts. You know, you have to get
as much light of the day as you can. I love it. You've got, you know, there's so much I want to talk to you about. I just love it. The book, The Old Ones of the Southwest, that's a story in Colorado. The Pyramids of the Black Pharaohs, the Kushite Kingdom of Nubia, and then Were There Real Amazon Women? We're not going to be able to answer that, but you have to get the book, right? It's so exciting to read. This should be in the house for kids to check out. Ann Williams, who's the general editor of the National Geographic Lost Cities, Ancient Tombs, 100 Discoveries That Changed the World. Where can people reach out to you?
Let me see. I have a Facebook page, and that's probably the best way. I am also the president of the local chapter of the American Research Center in Egypt, and people can look for that on Facebook. I share news about ancient Egypt every single day on that webpage.
I could talk to you forever. I'll be on
really
that webpage. Thank you so much for your time, Anne. Have a great one.
Thank you for having me. This has been fun.
Fun for me too. Take care.
Take care now. Bye.